Hello everyone, welcome to Current Affairs for Beginners. Let's start our today's session. Before starting our today's session, first we'll see answers for the questions from our yesterday's video. The first question is, consider the following statements about International Monetary Fund. International Monetary Fund plays a central role in the management of balance of payments difficulties and international financial crisis. We know that IMF plays three roles. One is surveillance role, the other one is lending role, and the other one is technical assistance role. Under the surveillance role, it will track the global economy as well as the economies of the member countries. And in the lending role, it will lend to the country whichever is facing the balance of payments difficulties. That means a country which is in the financial crisis. All the member countries will contribute funds to a pool through a quota system. So, a country whichever is having payment imbalances will borrow money from this pool temporarily. And the other one is technical assistance role. Under this role, the IMF will provide technical assistance and training to the member countries in the areas of expertise, which can be called as capacity building. So yes, it plays a central role in the management of balance of payments difficulties and international financial crisis. This statement is correct because it plays a role of lending role. IMF does require collateral from countries for loans to correct countries' macroeconomic imbalances. Yes, in order to loan to a country, it requires collateral. That means any surety from the country. So as both the statements here are correct, the answer here is both 1 and 2. The answer is C. The next question is, it is Africa's largest lake by area. It is the world's largest tropical lake. It is the world's second largest freshwater lake by surface area after Lake Superior in North America. The lake mentioned in the above quotation refers to, the answer here is D. It is Lake Victoria. Now let's start our today's session. Our first article is Supreme Court moves to make festivals less noisy. This article comes under GS paper 2 under the topic of governance. From this article here we are going to see about an organization called as Petroleum and Explosive Safety Organization. What is it? PESO is an apex authority to control and administer the manufacture, storage, transport and handling of explosives and petroleum, compressed gases and various other hazardous substances in India. This organization is entrusted with all these responsibilities under various acts like Explosives Act of 1884, Petroleum Act, Inflammable Substances Act and even the Environment Protection Act of 1986. This organization is a nodal organization to look after the safety requirements in manufacturing and storing and transporting and using these explosives and petroleum products. This organization functions under the Department of Industrial Policy and Promotion, DIP, under the Ministry of Commerce and Industry. And this organization is headed by a Chief Controller of Explosives and it is headquartered in Nagpur of Maharashtra. Our next article is Outcomes versus Promises. This article comes under GS Paper 2 under the topic of International Relations. From this article here we are going to see what is meant by this 2x2, CAATSA and S-400. In the foreign policy, 2x2. The term 2x2 is used for a dialogue mechanism between two countries that consists of the key ministries of defense as well as external affairs. These two key ministries will be involved in this dialogue mechanism where they will discuss on the strategic and security interests of the both the countries. The next one is CAATSA. Countering America's Adversaries Through Sanctions Act. It is a United States, USA's federal law that was imposed sanctions on Iran, North Korea and Russia. According to this CAATSA, it sanctions the countries that engage in significant transactions with Russia's defense as well as intelligence sectors. That means any country, whoever have transactions with Russia's defense and intelligence sector, even that country will face sanctions according to this law of United States. This is the next one is S-400 Triumph. This S-400 Triumph is one of the world's most advanced air defense systems. This system is made up of a large complex of radars, control systems, as well as different types of missiles. So using this complex system, it can simultaneously track numerous incoming objects like aircrafts, missiles, unmanned aerial vehicles, that is the drones. It can target various incoming objects in a radius of 400 kilometers and at an altitude up to 30 kilometers of range. It uses an appropriate missile system from its system to launch a counter attack and to neutralize the object that is attacking the system. And this system has a very high potential for ensuring the high success rate. This system is developed by Russia and it has been in service in Russia since 2007. Recently, India has signed a deal with Russia to purchase this S-400 Triumph missile systems. With this system, India can even destroy the Pakistani aircrafts even when they were in their airspace itself. So, in order to tighten the security in its nearly 4,000 kilometer long border, India has decided to procure this long-range missile system in order to strengthen its border security as well as to tighten its air defense mechanism. The next article is Trouble at the Top. This article comes under GS Paper 2 under the topic of governance. From this article here, we are going to see about two organizations. One is Central Bureau of Investigation and the other one is Central Vigilance Commission. First, we'll see about this Central Vigilance Commission. It is an apex watchdog of union government that is formed in order to address governmental corruption in government. It was initially set up by the central government in 1964 based on the recommendations of Santanam Committee on Prevention of Corruption. This organization, initially it is not a statutory body, but in 2003, as per the provisions of Central Vigilance Commission's Act of 2003, this was given statutory autonomous body status and it was given freedom of control from any executive authority. It is an autonomous body. So it is free from control of any executive authority according to this Act of Central Vigilance Commission. This commission is headed by a Central Vigilance Commissioner and it has two Vigilance Commissioners. These people, all these three, were appointed by the President based on the recommendations of a select committee. This select committee comprises of Prime Minister as its chairperson and Union Ministry of Home Affairs and a leader of second largest party in Lok Sabha or the majority group leader in the parliament, a leader of opposition. All these three were part of the select committee who will recommend these members of Central Vigilance Commission to the President, who will appoint them. This commission monitors all the vigilance activity under the union government, and it will advise various authorities in the government organizations in planning, executing, reviewing and reforming their vigilance work. And this CVC is authorized as a designated agency by the central government to receive written complaints for disclosing on any allegation of corruption or misuse of office and recommend appropriate action. That means this organization can receive written complaint from the aggrieved person on a corrupt official. And this organization can even recommend an appropriate action like a punishment on the corrupt official. The next one is Central Bureau of Investigation. This organization owes its origin to Delhi Special Police Establishment in 1941. Initially, it was established as this Special Police Establishment in order to inquire the cases of corruption during the Second World War. Later, based on the recommendations of Santanam Committee on Prevention of Corruption, CBI was established by a resolution of Ministry of Home Affairs. Initially, it was under the Ministry of Home Affairs. Later, it was transferred to the Ministry of Personnel, and it works under the Department of Personnel and Training under this Ministry of Personnel. And this organization, it gets its power to investigate on various cases from this Delhi Special Police Establishment Act of 1946. From this act, it will get its power to investigate on various cases. Whereas on matters related to corruption, it functions under the overall supervision of this Central Vigilance Commission on the matters related to prevention of corruption. So we can say that it is the foremost investigative police agency in India of the central government. As it is established by a resolution, it is neither a constitutional body nor a statutory body. And the CBI is headed by a director. This director of CBI will be appointed by the central government based on the recommendations of a committee that consists of Central Vigilance Commissioner. He is the chairperson, and Vigilance Commissioners and Secretary to the Government of India, who is in charge of the Ministry of Home Affairs and Secretary in the Cabinet Secretariat. All these will be the members of the select committee in order to appoint a director to the CBI. They will recommend it to the central government, and central government will appoint this director. Our next article is in the net. This article comes under GS Paper 3 under the topic of economy. From this article, here we are going to see about Central Board of Direct Taxes. First of all, what is meant by a direct tax? Direct tax is a tax that is directly paid to the government by an individual or an organization on whom this tax is imposed. Some of the examples of this direct taxes are like income tax, wealth tax, corporate tax, property tax, gift tax, all these. Wealth tax, in the sense, it is a tax that is imposed on the property possessed by an individual. The income tax is again of two types. It is of personal income tax and the corporate tax. Personal income tax will be levied on individuals as well as Hindu undivided families by the central government. So this income tax will be levied on the persons who will fall under this tax bracket. For example, if government says that a person who is earning more than 2,50,000 only he has to pay this income tax. That means people who are having income below this 2,50,000 rupees, then he will not fall under this income tax bracket. Corporate tax will be levied on the corporate companies, on the income of the corporate companies. And the other one is the capital gains tax. Capital gains tax in the sense, for example, a person owns a house and he purchased this house for 10 lakh rupees. After 2 years, he wants to sell this house. Now he's selling the house for 20 lakh rupees. That means he had got the profit of 10 lakh. That means a capital gain. He had invested 10 lakh, but he had got a profit of 10 lakh when he's selling the house. So a tax will be levied on the capital gain he got when he sold his house. This is called as capital gains tax. The tax will be levied on this profit, that is the 10 lakhs. Like this, there are various other direct taxes. So who will administer these direct taxes in India? It is the Central Board of Direct Taxes, which is a statutory authority that functions under the Central Board of Revenue Act. It got all its powers from this act, Central Board of Revenue Act of 1963, that made this authority responsible for administering the direct tax laws in India through the Income Tax Department. And this authority functions under the Department of Revenue in Ministry of Finance, where it will provide essential inputs for planning and making policy for direct taxes in India. Initially, this board was in charge of both direct as well as indirect taxes. But when the administration of taxes has become difficult for one board to handle, this board was split up into two. One is as Central Board of Direct Taxes, the other one is Central Board of Excise and Customs. Where this CBDT looked after this direct taxes, whereas this CBEC looked after the indirect taxes. But after this new indirect tax regime, that is the GST, this CBEC was renamed as Central Board of Indirect Taxes and Customs. Now it is no longer called as Central Board of Excise and Customs, but it is now called as Central Board of Indirect Taxes and Customs. And the chairman as well as members of this Central Board of Direct Taxes will be selected from Indian Revenue Service, that is the IRS, a premier civil service of India, whose members will be the top management of Income Tax Department. Our next article is healthcare costs should not financially destroy families. This article comes under GS paper 2 under the topic of governance and under the subtopic of health. From this article here, we are going to see about a scheme called as Pradhan Mantri Jan Aarogya Yojana. We have already seen this scheme so many times in our video. Here again, we'll see it in brief. This is a government-sponsored health insurance scheme that will provide free treatment up to 5 lakh rupees. It will provide a treatment for up to 5 lakh rupees to a family in a year. And the beneficiaries can avail the benefits of this scheme in any government hospital and in any empaneled private hospital all over India. Empaneled private hospital in the sense, under this scheme there were a list of private hospitals. Only in those hospitals you can go and get treatment, but not in all the private hospitals that were in India. This program is meant to help the poor as well as economically deprived. The scheme will be available for 10.74 crore beneficiary families and for about 50 crore Indian citizens. All the beneficiaries of this scheme will be listed out from the socio-economic and caste census database. And there is no limit on the family size and age of the family members. Anybody in a family can avail the benefits of this program. From the prelims point of view, from this article, we should know the particulars like how many beneficiaries and what is the amount it is going to pay and what is the priority of this scheme, to whom this scheme is prioritizing. It is prioritizing the girl child, women and senior citizens. And a free treatment is available at all public as well as empaneled private hospitals. And the most important thing is this scheme will cover only secondary as well as tertiary care hospitalization, but not primary care hospitalization. And under this scheme, all the pre-existing diseases will be covered. Our next article is CAC questions RBI's role when NPA crisis was brewing. From this article here, we are going to see about NPA. This article comes under GS paper 3 under the topic of economy. What is meant by this NPA? Non-performing assets. First of all, what is meant by an asset? See, every business, even an individual, will have their assets. Assets in the sense, anything that we own. For example, a car, a house or cash in your bank account, all these were the assets of an individual. Whereas in case of a bank, what are its assets? Asset is something that will make money for the bank, like cash, loans in the sense, if bank gives loan to a customer, he will give interest to the bank, which is an income to the bank for its investment in the form of loan. This is also an asset to the bank. And like government securities, all these will come under bank assets. Now, what is meant by this non-performing asset? For any investment that we make, we expect a return from that. In the same way, banks will lend to it customers. And these customers will pay interest. In case if a customer fails to repay the interest for 90 days, that asset is called as a non-performing asset. When a payment is overdue for a period of 90 days, then that asset will be considered as a non-performing asset by banks. Our next article is Centre's refusal to provide IGST refund hurts exporters. This article comes under GS paper 3 under the topic of economy. From this article here, we are going to see what is meant by this IGST, Integrated Goods and Service Tax. We know that this GST is a major indirect tax reform that was introduced in India by integrating all the major indirect taxes of center as well as state into one tax, by making it as one nation, one tax. So this tax is levied on a manufacture, sale and consumption of goods and services. And it is a destination-based tax. That means a state, whichever is consuming the goods and services, will get this tax. And this GST has three components. One is central GST, state GST, as well as IGST, that is the integrated GST. As the center and states are merging their indirect taxes under this GST, they also should get their own share in the GST. For this sake, the GST Council has adopted a dual GST with two components, that is the central GST as well as state GST, with an objective to share the revenue from the unified GST between the center as well as states. So the center and states will get share at 50:50 ratio, that is 50-50 ratio, except for in the case of IGST. For example, if a good is taxed at 18%, if it is of 100 rupees and it is taxed at 18%, it will be the tax amount, that is the 18 rupees, will be shared between the center as well as state as 9 rupees to the center as well as 9 to the states. And this state will be the state where this good is consumed. Because we said that this GST is a destination based tax. That means the tax revenue that has got in for as GST, state GST, will go to the consuming state but not to the producing state. So, in case of intrastate production, that means when the supply of goods is within the states and the consumption is also within the state, in the same state. For example, take a soap is produced in AP and it is also being consumed in AP itself. Then the tax, the share of SGST will be accrued by AP itself. But what is it in case of an interstate production? That means one state will produce the goods whereas some other state will consume this good. Here comes our IGST, Integrated Goods and Service Tax. So the Integrated Goods and Service Tax will come into the picture when the commodity or a service that is produced in one state and it is traded to another state. This is called as interstate trade. So according to the GST law under Article 269A, this integrated GST will be levied. That means it will be imposed and it will be collected by the central government only. After collecting this tax, the central government will transfer 50% of the tax to the state government who is buying. For example, AP has produced a soap and it has sold it to Telangana. So now the IGST which the central has collected and some share of this tax will go to Telangana, which has consumed this product but not the state which has manufactured this product. Because GST is a destination based consumption tax. Now let's see our today's questions. Our first question is, which among the following committees has recommended to set up Central Bureau of Investigation? Next question is, which among the following are the members of a select committee in appointing a Central Vigilance Commissioner? Try to answer these questions and post your answers in the comment box. Tomorrow we'll see a detailed explanation for these questions in our video. This is our Law Excellence website where you can access notes for this video. Thank you.